grab hands with the person next to you. I don't believe you're here by accident. I believe you're here by choice. And I believe because you obey God, what I want to do is add my faith to your faith that God is going to do something or say something that means something to you. Will you agree with that? All right. Well, Father, we thank you tonight for your word. I thank you, Lord, revelation knowledge shall flow freely, uninterrupted and unhindered by any satanic or demonic force. I thank you that as I decrease, you'll increase. I pray less of me and more of you, none of me and all of you. Think through my mind and speak through my vocal cords. Father, those things that you have determined before the foundation of the world are relevant to these your sheep. I thank you, Father, that no one under the sound of my voice will sit here in discomfort or pain. You said you sent your word and it healed them. So, Lord, I thank you for healing, emotional healing, physical healing, financial healing, and physical healing. It's in the mighty name of Jesus that I pray. And let all that agree shout amen. Shout amen again. All right. Well, give a couple of good-looking people around you a big old hug. Tell them you're glad to see them. I'm going to read something to you. How many of you ever heard of J. Vernon McGee? Now, it's really interesting. I bought all of his commentaries. And the interesting thing about J. Vernon McGee, he probably died 40, 50 years ago. You think, Deacon Mildred? Probably about 40 years ago. But the revelation, the perception of his perception of Scripture, his revelation, It's exciting to me. So I bought all of his commentaries. I've been had them for years. And, you know, I'm not one of those guys that want you to think I came up with everything. The Bible says a wise man will what? Hear and increase in learning. One of the things that I just treasure is the ability to read. That's why I love education. You know, I think sometimes because I kind of talk about people in education, that people don't think I value education. But if it wasn't for educators, I wouldn't know how to read, neither would I know the value of an education. Amen? So, you know, don't ever miss. I mean, there's problems in the system, but there are educators who are committed to their craft and what they do. Otherwise, my mother was an educator. You know, I've been had a library, well, I don't have one now, but when I was growing up, it was, you had to have a library card. You were going to the library, we didn't have internet. So you had to learn the Dewey Decimal System. Y'all remember that?
Yeah.
Some of y'all looking at me like, what? Who is Dewey? But anyway, this guy, there's some things that he talks about. And a lot of times when you hear me talk about the history behind the scriptures, I got it from J. Vernon McGee. He used to have a radio broadcast a long time ago. But I'm going to talk. Actually, I'm going to read from the Message Bible, Ephesians chapter 4. I might even sit down. It's important that you hear the whole chapter, okay? I mean, if it take me 30 minutes, okay. If it take an hour and a half, so be it. If you got 30 minutes and you leave, that's okay. But I think it's important The title of the message is Authentic Christianity. Being real. Being real. So, here's some things I want to share with you right off the bat that I read in here. I highlighted it. See, it's highlighted. And he talks about the difference between the first three chapters and the last, I think it's four chapters. He said in chapter 1-3 in Ephesians, we have considered the calling, construction, and the constitution of the church. The church of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is not an organization, it's an organism. It's a living organism. We don't have a religion, we call it that, but we have a relationship with a person, and that person is Jesus Christ. Amen? He said, in this last section of the epistles, we shall consider the conduct of the church. Conduct. Conduct. That's how we carry ourselves, what we believe, how we react to situations and circumstances that confront us. Our conduct. Look at your neighbor and say, you need to get your conduct right. Remember in school, you could have A's academically, but that was another grade. And I think the church is failing, not the whole church, but there are some people. When it comes to that conduct grade, we're not doing so well. And in these last days, it's important that you and I not only have academically great grades, but conduct-wise, because, you know, how I behave, how I deal with adversity is about my conduct. So where you grading on that level? Not what you know. Not the information that you've acquired and retained. You know, there's a lot of people know scripture. But they'll cuss you out in a minute. I'm just talking. I ain't talking about nobody. I ain't talking to nobody. Just talking. Look at your neighbor say, Pastor, just talking. I like what Pastor Ezell says. If the shoe fit, take it off. Right? All right. He said, in this last section of the epistle, we shall consider the conduct of the church, the confession, listen to this, the confession of the church, and the conflict of the church. The church, and I love this definition of the church, the church is a new man. Under the new covenant, the church is a new man. In the future, the church will be a bride. The Bible says that Christ is coming back for his church. He ain't coming back for buildings. He's coming back for people. We are the bride of Christ. Amen? Yeah. Now, let's get real. How many of you ever been to a wedding? How many of you know on wedding day, bride may be crazy. If she is, she contains it. Right? She gonna put her what? There you go. every time. I done married thousands of people, hundreds of people. I ain't seen nobody act a fool on that day. Not one. Not one. And it had to be a few crazies in there. Law of averages say some of them were crazy. I want you to see how Christ sees you. He says he's coming back for his church. You're the church. Revealing Truth Ministries is not the church. First, you know, New Bethel is not the church. Idlewild is not the church. You're the church. You're the church. Christ is not coming back for an institution. He's not coming back for an organization. The Bible says he's coming back for his bride. And his bride is the church. And you are the church. Okay? Right now, you ought to be feeling a sense of responsibility. What are you going to look like when he comes back? He's coming back for you. He calls you his church, his bride. How many of y'all ever been to a wedding? I mean, I know we have people that don't honor the institution of marriage enough to make it special. So, I mean, I don't know if they broke or they just don't have a clue. That this is God's idea, not man's. So they do all kind of crazy stuff. You know, like they're going to have a wedding. I saw online one time, somebody had a wedding with scuba gear on underwater. Stupid. I'm a scuba diver. That's crazy. You don't have a clue. You've turned it into an activity. It's more important than that. He says, let me read it again. In this last section of the epistle, we shall consider, talking about chapter 4, we shall consider the conduct of the church, the confession of the church. And watch this, the conflict of the church. The church is a new man. In the future, the church will be a bride. And the church is also, watch this, a good soldier of Jesus Christ. He said, are we able to stand and walk through the world in a way that is pleasing to God? Our Lord said that we are in the world, but what? Not of the world. That don't matter. So, do something and you will be somebody. That's what the world says. Do something and you'll be somebody. That's the world. Here's what God says. Be somebody and then you can do something that God values. So tonight, yeah, my book's falling apart. They real old. Go to Ephesians chapter 4. So I won't have you here all night. I'm not going to read the King James and the Amplified, then the Message. I'm just going to read the Message Bible. Is that all right? I was in one country. I think I was in Ukraine. The first time I spoke in English, and they had two interpreters for two different languages. You know how long that message was? They said it in Ukrainian, and then they said it in Russian. I said it in English, they said it in Ukrainian, then they said it in Russian. I was tired of waiting. All right, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. And it starts off with something I think is very interesting. It references the first three chapters. He said, in light of all of this, all of what? What he said in the first three chapters. And the first three chapters is laying the foundation of Ephesians, is laying the foundation for the church and how it should function, how it should operate. And now he's describing what that church is. And it's us, starting in verse 4, in chapter 4. He said, in light of all this, here's what I want you to do. While I'm locked up here, notice, Paul is in prison when he gets this revelation. A prisoner of the master. I want you to get out there and walk. Better yet, run on the road God called you to travel. I don't want any of you sitting around on your hands. I don't want anyone strolling off down some path that goes nowhere. And mark that you do this with, look at this word, two words, humility and discipline. If I had to sit down and say, well, what's the problem with Revealing Truth Ministries? Humility and discipline. Those two things. Humility and disciplines. Discipline. We got people that's been here long enough to think that what they do is more valuable than what God wants them to do. So nobody can tell them what they need to do. Look at your neighbor and say, don't let that be you. The worst place you can be is in a place where nobody can correct you, instruct you. The Bible says a wise man will hear and increase learning. And discipline, well, that's self-explanatory. Discipline produces consistency. Undisciplined people are erratic people. You can't depend on them. You don't know what they're going to do. Love you today, curse you out tomorrow. Right? I'm disciplined. I may not like you, but you'll never know it, because me not liking you is not your problem, it's my problem. I need to search myself and find out why I'm having a problem with you if God loves you. It's not your problem, it's my problem. Make sense? It's like what I say about marriage or love. Love always, everybody say always.
Always.
Love always seeks to give the advantage, not what? How long have I been saying that? Forever. So if I don't have a problem taking advantage of you, or if someone you know doesn't have a problem taking advantage of you, what you should know is they really don't love you. They don't love you. Yeah, but I feel something. Forget your feelings. How do he treat you? How does Christ treat you? Now, think about what I'm saying. I didn't pull that out the air. Jesus Christ himself gave his life for us. The Bible says while we were yet in sin, Christ died for the what? Ungodly. So his love for us seek to give us the advantage, not take advantage. He ain't trying to hurt you. He ain't trying to jack you up. He ain't trying to punish you. He loves you. He loved you so much, knowing you. And don't know nobody, nobody knows you better than God. Look at neighbor and tell him, you know that. You can tell him, you can fool Pastor Poe, but you can't fool God, right? He know the ugly. He know the nitty and the gritty. He know all of it. You ain't fooling him, right? And he still loves you. He still has your best interests at heart. He's still trying to work stuff out for you. Even when you're working against yourself. That's God. That's Christianity. That don't work. I don't know why I keep talking about this, but it's true. It doesn't work that way in any other religion on the face of the earth. Be a Muslim and jack something up. Steal something. They cut your hands off under Sharia law, right? Commit adultery. Fornicate if you want to. You better have enjoyed it. That's your last. Cut your head off in the middle of the street. Am I right? I said it Sunday. I'm going to say it again. I don't know why any woman, except the fact that she's been deceived by her history, her upbringing, would accept that religion. It don't make no sense. You know, in Saudi Arabia, unless you have permission by the government, a woman can't even drive. It's the law. How is that God? Jesus said, whom the Son set free is what?
Free indeed.
Come on, Pastor. Aren't you afraid to talk about stuff like that? No. Because it's truth. Jesus said, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. If you're not free, somebody locking you down. Somebody putting you in bondage. And it's not God. I like this. He said, better yet, run on the road that God called you to travel. I don't want any of you sitting around on your hands. I don't want anyone strolling off down some path that goes nowhere. And mark that you do this with humility and discipline, not in fits and spats, but steadily pouring yourselves out for each other in acts of love, alert at noticing differences, and quick at mending fences. How many of you notice lately how quick people are to cut off relationships? You ain't got to say amen, it's true. I'm done with them. Really? You just met them. You don't really know the value that God has intended for their involvement in your life to play 5 years down the road, 10 years down the road. And here's what I've discovered. It may not have nothing to do with the initial relationship. It may show value through your children or your grandchildren. But you cut it off because they didn't invite you to dinner or whatever. There's nothing more valuable in your life than the value of a long-term relationship. Amen? If God connected somebody to you spiritually, he has a purpose. Don't let Satan cut it off. Don't let him do it. Now, people dealing with pride, the Bible says pride cometh before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. Some people, especially with pride, they're not going to hear what God is saying. They only see what they want. Okay. You were called to travel on the same road and in the same direction. So stay together, both outwardly and inwardly. You have one master, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who rules over all, works, watch this, through all, and is present in all. Everything you are and think and do is permeated with oneness. Now, what does that mean? You know, there's really not, in God's mind, there's no such thing as a Baptist church, Methodist church, Catholic church, non-denominational church. If you believe in Jesus Christ and he's Lord of your life, then you're part of one church. There's only one church. When we get to heaven, the first thing we're going to lose is all these names. That's what I believe. That's what that says. And if we accept it that way, then we forget our doctrinal differences. Your doctrinal differences is based on your preference, not the gospel. Isn't it amazing? All these churches got the same book, right? I mean, it doesn't matter what version of the Bible you read. They're not that different. Some are translated into modern English, better for us to understand it, because that's what we read today. We don't talk in King James English. We don't go around saying thee, thuses, and thous. But it's the same word. And we all preach from the same book. Why are we not one as Christians? That's what religions like Islam, Buddhism, Hinduism use against us. Because they say we're fractionalized. We're really not, if we look at this. We are, because we tend to always want to steer towards our church. There's only one church. One church. It's the church of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. One church. Why? So that we'll be one. We'll be one. We're one people. Y'all all right? Listening to me? All right. Okay. You want to rush me? No, I'm just kidding. He said, listen to this, but that doesn't mean you should all, I love this, look and speak and act the same. That's why there's distinctions. That's why there's a Baptist church. That's why there's a Methodist church. That's why there's a non-denominational church, Episcopal church, Catholic church. You know, I've met saved priests. I'm on a board of a Catholic school. These guys are just as saved as you are. Their doctrine appears to be different, but the love of Jesus Christ is exactly the same. Why they do what they do, their motivation to be priests is the same as my motivation to be a pastor. And we talk about it. And I thank God for that experience. Amen? Because before that experience, I was prejudiced. Because I was led to believe that they are wrong. You know what I discovered? They got just as much right as I have right. And I might have some things wrong, just like they may have some things wrong, and Jesus will correct it when we get to heaven. But what I know, they love the Lord. You understand what I'm trying to tell you? So forget your prejudices. Love your brothers, love your sisters. If they love Christ, you love them. If they speak in tongues, well, if you speak in tongues and they don't speak in tongues, okay. That just means they don't understand that blessing. Or they've been taught through some doctrine not to receive it, but don't reject them. Because it's only one body. Are you listening to me? I was meeting with Pastor Ken Whitten, and we were, you know, when we had the unity meeting, it was so interesting. We all the pastors are sitting there, and he said, well, let's discuss some things that could be controversial so that, you know, as our congregations come together, we want to make sure that we display unity. And he thought that, you know, the doctrine of most Baptist churches, especially Southern Baptists, of once saved, always saved. Well, most Word of Faith churches for years were opposed to that. Pastor Dollar was, I was. But we changed once we got an understanding of grace. But Pastor Ken didn't know that. So he was preparing to make sure I wasn't offended because of a different perspective on that doctrine. And I kind of played it up a little bit. I let him go with that for a little while. And then I said, well, you know, Pastor Ken, I changed. He said, what? I changed after I got a revelation of grace. What I'm saying to you is, you know, when somebody change or repent or get a better understanding, they don't have to send you a memo. So you can be offended with somebody thinking they don't understand or believe something, and they've changed, got a better understanding. Amen? Trust that God can talk to them just like he's talking to you. All right. Oh, my goodness. That clock ain't right. That clock ain't right. Listen to this. It is not true that the one who I got to skip some stuff. Let me go down to verse 17. He said, and so I insist that God backs me up on this, that there be no going around with the crowd, the empty-headed, mindless crowd. They've refused for so long to deal with God that they've lost touch, not only with God, but with reality itself. They can't think straight anymore. How many of you know people like that? You're trying to show them the truth, you read it to them, just don't get it. He says, feeling no pain, they let themselves go in sexual obsession, addicted to every sort of perversion. But that's no life for you. You learn Christ. My assumption is that you have paid careful attention to him, been well instructed in the truth, precisely as you have in Jesus Christ, in Jesus. Since then, we do not have the excuse of ignorance. Everything, and I do mean everything, connected with that old way of life has to go. Look at your neighbor and tell him, it's time to change. It's rotten through and through. Get rid of it. I mean, if you're a new creature in Christ, what'd it look like you go to get a new car and they take the old seats out your old car and put them in the new car? You wouldn't accept that. No, new is new. He said, get rid of it. And then take on an entirely new way of life. A God-fashioned life. A God-fashioned life. Who fashioned your life? A life renewed from the inside and working itself into your conduct as God reproduce his character in you. Accurately reproduce his character in you. So that's what's happening. God's working on you. He's working on me. He's working on you. Now, I don't know about you, but I needed a lot of work. How many of y'all needed a lot of work? I needed a lot of work. But what I want you to see is, it's not just work, it's specific work. It's work towards a described objective, his character in you. He's working on his character in you. Not just so you'll be a better person, he's working on his character in you. You know, my marriage was like dead, crazy dead, really bad. And it didn't change until Deborah prayed and God began to show her what you need to pray for. Tell me if I'm right, but well, it's in a book. She began to pray that I become useful to God, not just a good husband. As she prayed that I become useful to God, that's what really started to change me. I didn't believe in this stuff. Not at all. Not even a little bit. My thought was, I don't believe it. I don't really want to do it. I don't see nobody benefiting from doing it. Why should I do it? And so my thought was, I'm not going to be a hypocrite. But then I began to look at her life, and I'm watching her life change. I thought she had I thought she was sleeping with a deacon at the church, and he was blessing her. That's what I thought. Yeah, I mean, she being blessed. I don't know nothing about no Jesus blessing. You understand what I'm saying? That's the truth. I mean, that's just the truth. So then I went to church to find out who this Negro is. It's the truth. Well, turned out it was Jesus. Then I'm upset with this Jesus person. I'm jealous of Jesus. That's truth. But then I could not ignore the fact my life was raggedy, but her life was good. She seemed to have peace. I ain't have no peace. I couldn't keep a job. Her job is blessing her. There's something wrong here. Truth. Look at your neighbor, say the truth shall make you free. So, unbeknown to her, I'm starting to pay a little attention. I still wasn't saved. I just didn't want to have that much to do with Jesus because I didn't know who he was. None of that made no sense to me, okay? And then she started telling me stuff like, you know, if you gave your life to Christ, he could really use you. I'm thinking, you out your mind. And my mom was actually telling her to leave me. That is not how I raised him. I don't see why you put up with a fool like that. I would leave. My mother said that. Her mother, on the other hand, said, what did God tell you? Wait a minute. It's, right? Because she wanted to go. Really, there wasn't no reason for her to stay. Actually, she asked me, she was transferring, her job was transferring her to Atlanta. And she asked me, so what do you think I should do? I don't give a flying blankety blank what you do. That's what I said, right? Shake the head. Huh? In essence, you want me to curse? What? I don't know why people don't want to tell the truth sometimes. Yeah. Well. So it wasn't good. And it wasn't getting no better. There wasn't nothing that said it was going to get any better other than the word of God. Okay? That's what changed some things. Are you listening to me? All right. Let me skip some more scriptures. Go down to verse 17. He said, and so I insist, God backs me up on this, that there be no going along with the crowd, the empty-headed, mindless crowd. They've refused for so long to deal with God that they've lost touch not only with God, but with reality itself. They can't think straight anymore. Feeling no pain, they let themselves go. Sexual obsession, addicted to every sort of perversion. But that's no life for you. Look at your neighbors, tell them, that's no life for you. You learned Christ. My assumption is that you have paid careful attention to him, been well instructed in the truth, precisely as we have it in Jesus. Since then, we do not have the excuse of ignorance. Everything, and I do mean everything, connected with that old life has to go. It's rotten through and through. Get rid of it. I can say for me, I don't know about the rest of you, I didn't know how to love anybody. Matter of fact, I didn't love anybody. I could care less. Now, I only do what I love. Totally different. The old Greg died. I can say stuff, but you probably wouldn't believe it even if I said it. So I don't need to tell you the dirty. Because you wouldn't believe it. Because I'm such a nice guy now. Right? And that's good. But that's how I know I'm saved. I didn't care. Now I do. I didn't know how to love. And there's a whole lot of reasons, you know, why I didn't know how to love and why I was skeptical of love and how I felt like nobody really could love me. And that's all true stuff. But it wasn't until I was introduced to Jesus Christ and the Word that I began to learn how to love. And it's not fake. It's real. And I know the difference because before I didn't care. Okay? And some of you are kind of in between somewhere. You need to get off the fence. Satan owns the fence. Look at your neighbor and tell him, Satan owns the fence. God said in the book of Revelation, I would that you were hot or cold. He said, because if you're lukewarm, I will spew you out of my mouth. One thing I'm not is lukewarm. I either love, and I don't hate nothing now. I mean, I've gotten over that. I mean, that's a blessing. Are you with me here? He said the old way of life has to go. Look at your neighbor, say, it's gotta go. You can't mix the old with the new. You can't put new wine in old wineskins. Oh, you gotta die. Amen. My job is to murder it. Absolutely destroy the old you. He said, it's rotten through and through. Get rid of it. And then take on an entirely new way of life. A God-fashioned life. A life renewed from the inside and working itself into your conduct. Working itself into your conduct, your behavior, your attitude. Amen? Do you know, I got to tell y'all a little bit so you'll understand how much I've changed. When people did stuff to me that I didn't like, I was like an assassin. I would sit outside people's house and watch their behavior, see when they came and went, and decide what I was going to do for retribution if they messed with me. That's what I did. I ain't giving you no details. But that's what I would do. And I didn't care. You know how some people want everybody to know that they got somebody back? I was satisfied to know I got you. I really didn't care if anybody else knew. It's wicked. I wasn't that way in the beginning, but that's how wicked Satan is. Whatever you think, going along with his plan, whatever you think the reward is or the benefit is, it's going to turn poison and get worse until he kills you. You understand? That's the truth, folks. That's what I love about Christ so much. I don't have that no more. I don't have that no more. You know, when you're abused sexually, it does something to you. It causes you, first of all, it causes you not to trust anybody. Anybody. You don't trust nobody. And you think, even with my parents, I was adopted, but my adopted parents, I'm thinking, why they let that happen to me? Maybe they know. Maybe they don't care. You understand what I'm saying? And that's some of you. There ain't but one way out of that, and that's Christ. Or you live your whole life in bondage. And you have to be totally free. The reason why I was such a whore is because I was trying to prove I wasn't a homosexual. Because of what happened to me. That's why I was such a whore. Until I got born again. You understand? People ask me, why you keep talking about that? Because people keep going through that. That's why. They're not free. And somebody need to be, I think me, you know, maybe God chose me, made me strong enough, bold enough, confident enough to say, hey, you don't have to keep hurting. Because I'm not insecure now. I'm free. Amen? Yeah. All right. Watch this and I'll be done. So we got to get rid of the old way of life, right? You don't bring nothing from your past into the new life with Christ. Nothing. It's useless. All your, well, intelligence is one thing, but don't let your intelligence supersede wisdom. He says, a God-fashioned life, a life renewed from the inside, working itself into your conduct as God accurately reproduces his character in you. So that's what he's doing. God is producing his character in Greg Poe, in you. What this adds up to then is this. Are you ready? No more lies. Look at your neighbor, says, stop lying. The Bible says that a liar cannot tarry in his sight. No more pretense. You are who you are. Enjoy who you are. You're not somebody else. Stop comparing yourself with other people. Stop comparing your life with their life. The Bible says they that compare themselves amongst themselves is not wise. You know, people looking at, oh, look at the size of their house. Look at the cars they drive. You don't know what it cost them to get that. They may not have gotten it legally. You don't know what they did. And you may pursue something that God doesn't want to be a distraction to you. It's like singleness. Single women, single men pursuing a husband. The Bible said, well, first for single women, it's nowhere in the Bible where it says that a woman to seek out the man, right? It said, he that findeth the... Now, all right. So, a lot of guys are going to get upset with me over this one, but it's the truth. If he ain't looking for a wife, what are you looking for? Did you ask him? Right? What are you looking for? If you're looking for a husband and he's not looking for a wife, y'all ain't on the same page. Is that not true? And if you're looking for a husband and he's not looking for a wife, and you ask him about it, and he says, I'm not ready for that yet, what should you do? Work harder? Y'all real quiet, boy. Like, oh, Jesus. Why is he going there? It's the truth. All right. Because it's not a God-fashioned life, right? And most people think marriage is going to solve their problems. No, it's not. Look at your neighbor and say, get a clue. You know what marriage does if you have a problem? You know what marriage does if you have a problem? Amplifies it. It's just like money. If you don't know how to manage money, more money ain't gonna help you. Because you don't know how to manage money. Right? It's you don't need no more money. Ain't gonna help you. If you can't balance your checkbook when you got, you know, a couple of thousand flowing through it, you don't need millions. You walk into the bank every month, how much I have in my account? And it's a fool walking right here. All the tellers are not honest. They fire them all the time, right? He worked for the bank. That's why I'm telling. Some of y'all don't understand that. Some tellers waiting on you. How much I got in my account? They look at it. You got about 300. Actually, you got 800. You just lost 500. Because you don't know. Just saying. All right. A God-fashioned life, a life renewed from the inside and working itself into your conduct as God accurately reproduces his character in you. What this adds up to, then, is this. No more lies, no more pretense. Tell your neighbor the truth. In Christ's body, we're all connected to each other. All of us. When you lie to others, you end up lying to yourself. I'm just reading it. Different version of the Bible, but it's true. I like this. He said, go ahead and be angry. You do well to be angry. But don't use your anger to fuel your revenge. As fuel for your revenge. And don't stay angry. Look at your neighbor says, just set a time limit on your stupidity. On your anger. I call it stupidity. You think about people that are angry with folk they live with. How dumb is that? I remember a couple in this church, when the wife got mad with her husband, she would not speak to him for weeks. I mean, not even casually, not like, you know, you're gonna take the garbage out, nothing, not a word, not a peep. It was her way of punishing him. I would have hit her in the head. Went to jail. Nah, I wouldn't have done that. I'd have just left. But why? Why do that? I like what Pastor Dollar said. When you're angry, ask yourself one question. What is it that you're afraid of? What is it that you're afraid of? You shouldn't be angry. That's not part of God's nature for you. Never be angry. Get over it. Get through it. Work it out. Talk. What did I do? Can I fix it? Can it be fixed? Whatever. I don't want this. Amen? You hurt yourself when you're walking around angry. And the longer you walk in anger, the longer you're walking outside of the will of God. You know, I'm not mad with anybody. Not at all. And that's a good place to be. That's a real good place for me to be. Am I disappointed with some people? Yeah. But the Bible says that we should cast our cares upon the Lord because he cares for us. Amen? Don't be angry. Don't be angry. Especially if you're husband and wife. The Bible says, don't let the sun go down upon your wrath. So whatever you're upset about, fix it before you go to bed. Right? Y'all listening to me? Or you gonna be up all night? I hate them kind of nights. Just up all night, just talking. Every man in here, every married man have gone through this pain. We need to talk. Right? All right. So y'all looking at me funny. Watch this. I'm going to see how be the bold men we have here tonight. Married men. How many of you have had to endure a night after those words? Look around. We don't like that. It's true. But it's good. Because it's what the word says. Are y'all listening to me? If this is going to be your best year yet, we got to deal with kind of some natural things. I don't like them conversations either. Deborah come to me and said, we need to talk. Oh. Here we go. We all like that. I don't like it. You like it? I don't like it. Nobody likes it. But you got to talk. Why? So you can deal with whatever needs to be dealt with. Hello? Am I being too honest and open? I'm just trying to tell you. If you don't, then what's the result? What's the consequences of not talking, not being open, being honest, being whatever. You know. So, listen to this again. I like the way it's worded. Go ahead and be angry by yourself. Go in the closet, go in the bathroom, go outside, yell, shout, scream, get yourself together, after, be angry, get it all out, but then change, reflect, and realize it's not good for me to be angry. That's what I get out of this. The Bible says that Jesus was angry, but he sinned not. What does that mean? He had no response to his emotion. He had emotion. That's what anger is. It's an emotion. But he did not respond to the emotion. That tells me he took some time to consider the consequences, the circumstances, the reaction. How many of you know you can say stuff that you wish you wouldn't have said? Can't get it back. If you say it in anger, I mean, out of the abundance of the heart, that's what you really meant. And sometimes you don't, you just, you know, it may be true, but you don't need to say it. Pay somebody else to say it for you. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. No, you don't. You really don't. That's why you're hesitant. You know, if you're hesitant, let me say it this way. If you got to think about whether you should say something or not, you shouldn't say it. Your spirit is telling you, don't say it. There's no point. There's no victory. There's no reward. Even if you get your point across, what did it cost you? Right? End of the day, you win nothing. All right. Well, I'm way over my time, but that's okay. Are you here? So he said, go ahead and be angry. You do well to be angry. But don't use your anger as fuel for revenge. And don't stay angry. Look at your neighbor and say, don't stay angry. Some of y'all bad about stuff that happened 20 years ago. And the person you with now wasn't even around. It's somebody else that did it. And now you blaming this person. Or your fear is saying, because all anger is related to fear. Again, I like what Pastor Dollar said. When you're angry, ask yourself, what is it I'm afraid of? Am I afraid of being taken advantage of? Am I afraid of being left, abandoned, hurt? What is it? Ask yourself. Get the answer you need to secure yourself and protect yourself against your response to being angry. Amen? Are you hearing what I'm saying? He says, so go ahead and be angry. You do well to be angry. Don't use your anger as fuel for revenge, and don't stay angry. Don't go to bed angry. Stay up all night for days talking. Don't give the devil, listen, that kind of foothold in your life. Don't do it. Don't do it. You understand? He said, that's all you're doing. All you're doing when you're angry is giving the devil access into your life. God has called you to peace. Peace that passes all understanding. So if you're sitting there angry, upset, mad, ready to cut somebody, ready to, you know, do something crazy, Satan has access. And he's ruining your life and your joy and your peace. That's not the grace life, and that's not your best year ever. All right, so let me finish. He said, did you use to make ends meet by stealing? Well, no more. Get an honest job so that you can help others who can't work. Now, that's the Message Bible, just making it real plain. Look at your neighbor and say, if you ain't working, and you worried about, and you complaining about your needs, get a job. And stop your pressure. Don't nobody owe you no more than what you earn. You ain't, if you watch a Jerry Springer, he paid. You're not paid. You complain about what you don't have, what did you do? Well, I can't find nothing in my field. You unemployed, you don't have a field. Trust that God will anoint you in any position to promote you so that supernaturally your needs are met. Amen? I've done it before. I went to work as a cashier in a convenience store. Couldn't find a job. I couldn't find a job because prior to that, I worked for Pinkerton. And my job at Pinkerton was to investigate companies that were involved in some type of fraud. So after working for them and got fired by them, nobody wanted to hire me because they thought I was just going to investigate them. They looked at my resume. You got college. You're overqualified for this job. Why are you applying for a job as a busboy? Because I can't get a job doing nothing else. Why are you applying for a job as a cashier in a convenience store? Nobody trusted me. I could not get a job. I mean, you know how frustrating it is to sit in the interview broke as dirt and somebody telling you you overqualified? Where you get that from? Anyway, so I had to go through this whole thing of, okay, got the job. Then I had to prove to the people at this convenience store that I'm not just a cashier. Within 3 months, I was managing the store. I wasn't even saved, but I knew I had more potential than a cashier. I went to work. I did things on the job that they didn't expect. You ever been in a convenience store and the icing machine hoses were dirty? Icing machines, y'all know what those are? I clean the hoses on the icing machine. The manager says, nobody never thought of doing that. I stripped and waxed the floors. I got the dirt out of the corners where the wax had built up. I ended up being a regional manager because my store made more money than all the other stores in the region. Why? Because I wasn't just a cashier. What are you saying, Pastor Poe? You letting other people define who you are so you start performing based on what they said, not on who you really are. Are you with me? Especially if you're saved. God will anoint everything you do. Everything you put your hands to, to prosper. Amen? He says, so did you use to make ends meet by stealing? We don't do that as Christians. God ain't got to rob somebody else to bless us. I don't have to take something from you in order for me to be blessed. He said, no more. Get an honest job so that you can help others who can't work. Watch the way you talk. Grace-filled mouth, right? Let nothing foul or dirty come out of your mouth. Say only what helps. Each word a gift. That's very important. Life and death is in the power of the tongue. So make sure every time you speak, every word you speak is a gift. It's a gift. It's going to bless somebody. Yeah, but they're not saying that to me. Well, then you be the better person. Don't grieve God. Don't break his heart. His Holy Spirit moving and breathing in you. If you say, that's the reality. He said, is the most intimate part of your life, making you fit for himself. Don't take such a gift for granted. Make a clean break with all cutting, backbiting, profane talk. Be gentle with one another, sensitive, forgiving one another as quickly and thoroughly as God in Christ forgave you. That's the whole chapter. Amen? I think if you take your time and read it for yourself, it'll really, really bless you. I would encourage you, read it in the Amplified and then read it in the Message Bible. It's just so clear that we're going to live and experience our best year ever. Ephesians chapter 4 is critical. It'll help you. Amen? Yeah. I realized a couple of years ago, I really didn't have a problem. All of my problems was other people associated. In other words, all of my problems was because I was carrying their problems. Stop carrying other people's problems. You got sisters, brothers, children, husbands, wives, co-workers, friends. Stop carrying their burdens. Stop allowing them to dump the weight of their suffering on you. Amen? You said, Pastor, you mean just don't care about them? No, I'm saying pray for them, but don't carry the burden of their issues. You were not designed for that. You care about their outcome, but you can't fix it. Go ahead and tell somebody, you can't fix it. You all know that by now. You can't fix the problem. You can't fix them. You can pray for them. You can encourage them. But just like you had to make a decision to change, they have to do likewise. Amen? Is that all right? It's the truth. It's the truth. And you're going to have your best year ever. Say this with me. Unload. Dump it. Move away. Forget about it. God's on your side. Amen. You don't have no problem. Listen to me. I'm talking to a bunch of people here tonight. You don't have a problem if you get rid of their problems that you've been carrying. Amen? Amen. Especially some of you parents with older children. They grown. Two things you can't do with grown folks. You can't raise them. And what's the other one? Can't tell them what to do. They keep telling you what they're not going to do or showing you what they're not going to do, and you keep getting frustrated, right? Losing your peace. Keep reading Ephesians chapter 4, and you'll be all right. You get anything out of the word? All right.